whenever language we speak and wherever we are in the world, our speech is the most pervasive way that we connect with one another. It is one of our most human qualities. So what happens when our speech is tampered with? What happens when people who crave connection and love talking can not easily get out the words that they want to express themselves? Just like many people here, I began to find out the answer to that question at a very early age. For me, it was at about the age of 7. I had probably been bubbling my words forward before then, but it was only at the age of 7 that I realized that I was different, that I was a stutterer. It was then that I became afraid of the lack of control I seemed to have over my voice, afraid of suffocating on my stillborn words. I felt as if someone was jamming a stopper into my throat as half-formed broken words shuddered out of my mouth. I trusted my voice less and less to create the words that were piling up in my brain. Gradually, I began to look away from my listener, afraid of the reactions that I would see. When we are young, we are molded by the responses of others. As the singer Bill Withers told me, the first learning that we all go through is learning how to manage other people's reactions and other people's perceptions. As young children, we see our faults and our successes in their eyes and in their posture. As a child, I saw that my speech laid me bare to be judged, that it was a very public problem that exposed me every time I opened my mouth. There were always those who waited, those who kept coming towards me, those who instantly saw beyond the mask of stuttering. But the reactions that stuck with me were the people who stared, who laughed, who shifted uncomfortably in their seats or turned away. I heard well-meaning strangers tell me to slow down, to calm down, to take a deep breath, as if stuttering was caused by common laziness, as if it was so easily overcomable. I suppose that the the problem is that stuttering tends to look like something that people have seen before, something that perhaps they recognize in their own speech. In many people's minds, stuttering tends to not to be linked up with the most attractive of attributes. People perhaps assume that we are unintelligent or nervous or angry or perhaps even secretive. Or so I thought. I was always convinced that I was an expert mind reader. But I have no doubt that the most damning misconceptions were always the ones that I had of myself. As a child, I felt guilty and ashamed and at war with my uncontrollable body. I quickly learned that the only way to escape the reactions I didn't want to see was to escape into violence. My parents watched their once confident child become shy and withdrawn. They began to telescope my future, worrying about whether I would make friends and wondering what a job I might someday have. Worried about my personality transformation, they spoke to their doctor. And he told them not to worry, that I would in all likelihood just outgrow it on my own, that the stutter was just a kind of hiccup in the path of childhood development. However, my stutter seemed to be resolutely sticking around, and my confidence was plummeting. So my parents did what the doctor told them to do, and they acted as if everything was normal. Outwardly, they smiled, and they didn't ever rush me. But inwardly, they worried, and they decided that they had to do something. They had to do something to help. So they did their homework and they signed me up for the speech therapy that they could. And as much as I hated the word speech therapy and all of the abnormality that it seemed to imply, I was grateful that we were talking about it, that this thing had a name, that perhaps it had a treatment. I kind of had it in my head that perhaps stuttering was like having a cold, and speech therapy would be my medicine. We all hoped that I would come out of it fixed. At first, it seemed as if I had. In the wake of the 2-week course, my stutter seemed to have disappeared, and I reveled in the praise-filled attention from all of my family and friends. However, I was doomed for a fall, And only two weeks after the end of the course, I began to taste the familiar shape of the stuttered words come out of my mouth. Disappointment racked my body as I registered the confused faces of everyone around me. In all of our heads, the technique was beyond reproach, and so all eyes turned to me. Guilt and failure became new words in my vocabulary. Stuttering was no longer something that just happened to me. It was now something that I had tried to overcome and botched. Looking back, I wish that I could tell myself and my parents that therapy wasn't the cure that we all hoped that it could be. Stuttering is an enigmatic condition with many more questions than answers. And researchers are still trying to pinpoint the exact cause. Speech therapy treats the symptoms and the responses to the stutter, the tension, the breathless words, and the self-criticism, rather than addressing the underlying causes. The best speech therapists I know, and I know hundreds of them, do not promise fluency. Rather, they teach their clients how to be confident and eloquent, how to speak in a way that feels like a victory. Unfortunately, at the age of 8, I was still in the dark. I believe that I had been tricked by speech therapy and all its weighty promises. And I decided that my stutter was something I would have to overcome by pure force of will. I didn't have any stuttering role models. Porky Pig was hardly a leader of men, and the odd stutterer that I came across in kind of Hollywood movies was always passed as the comedy sidekick. Sorry, I've lost my place. I couldn't imagine what would happen to me if I grew up stuttering, so I promised myself that I would change. I made myself practice saying my name out of the window 10 times every morning, and I began to watch and listen to others obsessively, hoping to mimic the easy rhythm of their voices. I saw my stutter and I as somehow separate, as two forces fighting against each other in my body. So I devised a variety of tactics to thwart my stutter whenever possible. Having realized that I didn't stutter when I spoke in the accents, I began to pepper my everyday conversations with a variety of horrendous origin unspecific accents. I became a gymnast at word substitution. I was changing everything from the food that I wanted to order in a restaurant to my own name if I wanted to fluently introduce myself to some cute guy at the bar. Finally, and perhaps most sensibly, I chose a group of friends who I was able to trust. I surrounded myself with people who were loyal and boisterous and kind. I largely pretended that my stutter was little more than a passing nuisance, and none of us ever spoke about it. But all that anyone else could see was the way that I laughed off any stutters, the way that I pushed past them. The way that I tried to speak up regardless. What they didn't see, what perhaps I didn't want anyone to see, was the wealth of fear and insecurity that lay beneath the surface. Silently, as I made my way through school and university and out into the world of work, my stutter started to dominate and cloud all of my thoughts. I had always wanted to be a writer, but I couldn't imagine how I would earn a living at it. So I turned to the next best thing, or so I thought, journalism. Standing in the open plan newsroom of the Telegraph, I realized that I had not properly thought it through. It turns out that journalism largely consists of talking on the telephone and aggressively spouting out questions at press conferences. This isn't exactly my ideal job. I was interning at the paper's society section, and my job involved hounding celebrities in order to get some juicy gossip for the next morning's paper. I quickly started to rethink my chosen career. I decided to turn to something where I thought that I would be quietly sitting behind a computer. A job where I thought that I could hide from demonic devices like the telephone. Telling everyone that it was just about the money, a partial truth, I put down my reporter's notepad and I took up a job in finance. 2 years later, at the age of 24, I knew that something had to change. I had called a client on the telephone in our large open plan office. It may have been my imagination, but I recall the room becoming completely silent as I dialed. My anxiety mounted with each ring, and then my listener picked up, and I couldn't say a single word. I stuttered and repeated and pushed and flicked my head, and I got nowhere. The client asked me to repeat myself. Jokingly, he asked if I had forgotten my name. A bright blush came over my cheeks, and my heart began to race even faster, and anger flooded my brain. Still to this day, I marvel at the stupidity of that question. At the time, I just couldn't handle it any more. Because for me, the worst part of stuttering had always been the humiliation of being out of control in the presence of others. So sitting in that office, I put all of my best acting skills to work. So that no one else could see me, I pulled out the cord on the telephone. I disconnected the cord, however, I carried on. "Charles, but are you there?" I acted as if he had, you know, as if he was on his mobile phone, and he had cell phone reception, and as calmly, and I then kind of hung up. And I told anyone who was listening that, you know, he had been disconnected. And then I walked to the bathroom, and I broke down for the first time that I could remember. I felt trapped. I felt as if I was living someone else's life, as if I was constantly pretending to be someone else. I was petrified that I wouldn't ever fulfill whatever potential I had, afraid that my life would be ruled by something as uncontrollable as my voice. So, after this whole episode, the first thing that I did was I turned to speech therapy. But it wasn't enough. It somehow just, it didn't give me everything that I was hoping for. So in September 2008, I handed in my resignation. I booked a flight from London to Boston, and I set off on a year-long adventure, traveling around America, searching for answers. As I traveled around the country, I set up interviews with scientists at the forefront of today's research. I spoke with excellent scientists like Dr. McGuire, who spoke at the conference, and the geneticist Dr. Drainer. I was told that stuttering is a neuroanatomical weakness, that it is bound up with our complex genetic code and the plastic chemistry of our brains. I learned that there is no cure, but scientists enthusiastically told me that one could still be discovered within my lifetime. Gradually, I moved away from the safety of speaking with researchers, and I reached out to other stutterers. Having spent my life shying away from any mention of my stutter, I immersed myself in this incredible world that I hadn't ever realized existed. I couch surfed with everyone from dumpster divers to ranchers. I broke down, I hitchhiked. I was helped out by the police more times than I should probably admit. And perhaps most importantly, I was told hundreds of stories of courage and heartache and joy. I spoke to a man who repeated and blocked on every word and had won a handful of Toastmaster public speaking competitions against fluent speakers because he was so humiliated, and he thought that he was so limited by his stutter. And I watched kids on stage stuttering up a storm as they wriggled and acted in front of hundreds of eager faces. I met people who became role models for the way that I wanted to live my life. I met men and women who were in every career that I once thought impossible. People who taught me that what we did and what we said was far more important than the number of beckons that it took us to say it. I met people who were successful not in spite of their stutters, but actually because of them. For instance, there was Alan Inuits, a renowned big cat conservationist, and Indiana Jones sort of type person, who was so ostracized and bullied as a child that he could only speak to animals. And he swore to these animals that if he was ever able to control his voice, he would use it to be the bears. There was also Roisin McManus, who's a nurse, and she thinks that he is more able to empathize with her patients because stuttering has taught her about the depths that people go to when something difficult is put upon them. I saw how stuttering could be a password and an equalizer. As I was welcomed into the homes and the lives of everyone from celebrities like Emily Blunt and Michael Palin to sportsmen and business executives. As the year drew to a close, I had also fallen in love with another stutterer for the first time in my life. When it came time to actually write my book, I thought that it would sort of be a collection of all of the stories that I had been told by everyone. I thought that I would be able to kind of hide behind the role of narrator. However, as I began to actually write the book, I realized that I was no longer interested in distancing myself from these people or this condition. I decided that I had to allow myself to be as vulnerable as the hundreds of stutterers who had generously told me their stories. So I radically changed the book and I turned it into a memoir, making my life the thread that wove all of our stories together. Stuttering isn't an easy thing. It takes away the control that we want to have over our appearance and over our language. It eases us and spares us. However, it can also foster the best parts of us. It can be something to be proud of, rather than something to be ashamed of. It can make us humble. It can show us the best in people and the worst in them. It can make us sensitive to the world around us, and it can encourage us to relish the everyday victories that we have fought. Today I can see that my Stutter has given me far more than it ever took away. Having spent a lifetime thinking about words and watching how others communicate. I am obsessed with the rhythm of language. Just like the long history of stuttering writers, a childhood spent collecting words and observing the world around me, has served me well in my writing. Rather than holding me back and isolating me, there's a lot of M's in this. My Stutter has given me the career that I always dreamed of, and it has introduced me to the man that I want to grow old with. My Stutter is no longer an enemy that I am forever at war against. Rather, my speech has become something that I can, hopefully. I can, oh my goodness. No, it's not clapping now. I'll never get anywhere. Something that I can play with. As counterintuitive as it sometimes seems, I try to voluntary stutter whenever I can, to get away from the fear of it, and to treat stuttering more like a game and less like a war. I walk towards things that scare me, and I laugh at all of the awkward situations that my Stutter gets me into. Yeah, you can definitely clap that. growing up, I didn't want to be vulnerable, and I always thought that my stuttering kind of made me feeble. Because everyone was able to see my greatest weakness as soon as I opened my mouth. It turns out that I was wrong. It seems that for all of us, for everyone in the whole world, success and strength comes from letting ourselves be seen, from believing that we are in health. The people that I want to spend my time around are the ones who laugh at themselves, the ones who are uncertain, the ones who embrace those imperfect moments when they are recklessly human. Thanks, everybody.
Imagine at some point it wasn't easy for you.
Yeah, exactly. I'm still up here, still talking.
You did great. Thank you very much. I really enjoyed it. I'm sure everybody did. You also get the statue.
Yay!
Everybody wants it. And the goodie bag.
Cool. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions? I think that we have
lots of time.
So, if anyone has any.
Hi everyone. Right, this is working. Hi Katherine. Thank you for a great speech. Really enjoyed it. A simple question, really. You went around interviewing people, I believe. Some of them quite famous, like Emily Blunt. Mm-hmm. How easy or how difficult was it to get hold of those people and agree for them to be interviewed?
It was actually quite, I mean, I kind of had to work out how to reach out to their agents and everything, but once I was able to actually get hold of the celebrity, they were actually extremely open, and they really kind of they are wanted to be able to talk about it, and I was actually kind of shocked by how easy it was, and how, I mean, they would just welcome me into their kind of homes and everything. There were obviously some of them who I reached out to who weren't as interested, but yeah.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, for sure.
Can I pass it over?
I really hate microphones. I was just wondering how the day when you decided that you were going to put your own story into the book. How it felt to actually take the decision to tell your own story and put that as well and publish it in a book.
I realized that I had created a whole draft of the book that didn't have any of my own story in it, and it just wasn't excellent. It was dry, and I thought that I could. Well, I kind of hoped that I would be able to write a more kind of compelling book
So I decided to put my own story in there, and it was a kind of odd sensation of hanging up all sorts of old memories that perhaps I had kind of hidden for a while, and it was a kind of hard thing to do, but I think ultimately it was sort of a kind of healing, a catharsis to be able to write a honest book where I wasn't kind of hiding in any way.
Fantastic, thank you. You've got me completely solved.
Yes.
Hello, I have been offered another a microphone. I have distinct memories which often come to mind that when I was asked difficult things, I used my stutter to my advantage, as when I would be in a real strong block that I couldn't get out of, or when I was in repetition, which obviously you were, which I've been there, done that, got a t-shirt, I used to use my brain to think up the answer, and then I'll work out how to better answer. Has this ever helped you?
Sorry, I think I'm not quite sure of the question.
All right.
Ask me again.
I use my stutter to my advantage, so I could keep thinking up what would be a reasonable answer. Have you ever done that?
Okay. That's interesting. I think that actually when I'm stuttering, I don't think I'm thinking ahead in this sentence. I think that I'm kind of in this muttering moment. I mean, I think it's sort of helpful in all sorts of ways, but I don't think that I ever kind of think of a different answer as I'm muttering. Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure. I think I
asked
that very well, but no
problem. Yes.
Mark, thank you. Yeah. Hi. First, as you've heard me tell you several times, Katherine, it's a brilliant book. I highly recommend it. Please buy a copy. Even though you turned the journey inward in the writing, that the outward journey is still very evident. You drop people into the book throughout and offer their wisdom in order to illuminate yours. And I felt like embedded in the book was a great road book, a great journey, that because of how you structured it, we never really saw fully. And I'm curious, what does America look like through the living rooms of people who stutter?
That's an excellent question, and it's really made me kind of hard one to answer, but I'll try. What does America look like for the living rooms of people who stutter? It is a shockingly welcoming country. I mean, a stutterer is anything to pie. I mean, in traveling, there was always someone who would offer a room. There was always a welcoming kind of home to stay at. And
I mean, I was shocked how comfortable everyone was with just opening up their kind of homes. I mean, I was a stranger to everyone, and yeah, it was unbelievable actually how courageous everyone was and how generous everyone was. In terms of the actual traveling, there were times when it just seemed like the country was so huge, and I wasn't sure how I would ever sort of get around to speak to all of these different people in tiny little towns in the middle of nowhere. So perhaps that's answered some of your question, kind of.
I have to admit, I'm very impressed by your speech and the way you deal with the whole topic. It's a bit of a provocative question. At the very beginning of your journey, if there was the red and blue pill, the one is for stuttering and the one for fluent speech, mm-hmm. after the things you've said, which one would you pick and why?
Sure. Goodness. I think that when I was growing up, I would have instantly swallowed any cure that was out there. I think that these days it's perhaps harder. I mean, I obviously would. It would be great if it was easier. I think that the challenge of stuttering is always interesting, and I don't think that it's always an easy thing. But I think that if anyone gave me the option to be fluent, it would be a hard thing. It would be a hard thing to refuse, but it would also be a hard thing to take up. Because I honestly don't have any idea who I would be if I didn't kind of have it. And also, it's how I've created a whole career. So if I didn't have this, I wouldn't be able to earn anything, which would be a small problem. So, yeah. Make the money.
Okay. I'm not so used to talk to in a microphone, but I have a question. It sounds very interesting. Book that you have written, but how long the took to read the book?
Yeah, so I began the research in September 2008, and then I was traveling and interviewing everyone for basically a year, and then I had to transcribe all of them, which takes an extremely long time, and then I began the actual writing. So I probably began the writing at the beginning of 2010, and I handed in final draft of the book to my publisher in April 2012. So it took me a really long time. That's the short answer. Yeah.
I think that your book sounds very interesting. So I won't want to buy a copy.
Right. Catherine, I'd like to commend you on your speech that you did, and I just love the way when you smile, when you stutter, you have a great smile, which
What I wanted to ask you was, during your speech there, you said that you enjoy writing, you're a journalist, and that this is now your career. Now, I gather that this is your first book. I'm very interested to know if you've given any thought to the sort of things that you'd like to write about in coming books that you choose to do.
Yeah. I've tried to think of a topic that I would be as interested in as I am in stuttering, and it's actually quite kind of hard because there isn't anything else that's as personal. And there probably isn't anything else that I am as passionate on. However, I am saying that writing is a career. So I have to obviously be able to write about something else at some point. And I'm kind of hoping to be able to write a novel. And perhaps it will include Stuttering, or perhaps it will include the way that stuttering can affect us. I think that the whole idea of weakness as strength is an interesting concept. So hopefully I'll begin writing something else at the end of this year here, so I'll keep everyone informed for sure.
Last question.
Given that stuttering is quite a niche kind of subject, how hard was it to find an editor or a publisher who would take up the project, or did you have to kind of talk them into it, or were they quite eager to get on board with the whole thing?
Yeah, I mean, it was hard. I sent out the book to probably about 100 agents, and often I sent out to kind of hundreds of agents, and I only heard back from perhaps 20 of them, and often, and all of the ones that I heard back from were all rejections. And often they would say in their rejection that stuttering wasn't an area that kind of had enough of an audience. However, when I ended up with the publisher and the editor that I kind of have, they are extremely interested in stuttering, and they are behind it 100%. And also, I mean, the book is about stuttering, but it also relates, or I kind of hope it does, to anyone who is kind of handling anything. I mean, and everyone has something. Stuttering is just the thing that everyone here has, but everyone has some kind of a thing that they aren't kind of happy with, that they're always a challenge. I kind of hope that it actually has a audience in the outside world, and I think that that's perhaps the only way that it will really change the whole conversation, if it's read by everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.